Greetings, everyone. I'm very honored to be a part of this important series and to offer the final presentation in 2011. My video camera is going in and out of focus and may jump around some, for which I apologize. But let's turn to this issue of locating developmental evaluation and applying complexity concepts to enhance innovation and use. Evaluation has a number of different purposes, and so developmental evaluation adds to the options available for us in distinguishing different kinds of purposes. The classic and most well-known purposes are the distinctions that our philosopher Michael Quinn gave us between formative and summative evaluation, where the purpose of formative is to improve a program and the purpose of summative is to make an overall judgment of merit or worth to support major decisions about whether an intervention or a program or project should continue or expand or decrease. And these are often associated in developing countries with midterm and end of project reviews, although summative evaluations can occur at midterm and formative evaluations can appear at the end of projects. I was doing a classic 5-year formative summative evaluation contract with a community leadership program in Minnesota, where I'm located and where I'm coming from you today. The program was aimed at supporting rural community leadership development, and it involved taking rural leaders into a retreat setting for a week to increase their communication skills, strategic planning, dealing with community indicators, and a variety of skill building and community planning and project development activities. At the end of 2.5 years of improving the program, the contract called for 2.5 years of summative evaluation, during which time the program would be stabilized so that we could do the summative evaluation. As we went to make that transition, the program realized, and the program participants from their feedback and the program staff and funders realized that in fact they didn't want to create a stable, standardized intervention. They didn't want to create a best practices set of steps that would be replicated over and over again, but that in fact they wanted to continue to develop the program, to adapt it to changing conditions. They realized that every time there was a change of government in Minnesota, rural policies changed and they needed to update the program. That as technology changed and cell phones came into the rural sector and the internet emerged, that they would have to change the program. That as economic booms and busts went on in farming communities, that they had to change the program. That as immigrants to Minnesota moved out into rural areas, that they would need to update the program to deal with demographic changes. And so in discussing how to approach that, we came up with the idea of doing developmental evaluation, where a program continues to develop rather than trying to stabilize and standardize an intervention or model. That development occurs in relation to changes in the environment and increased knowledge and understanding within the program itself. So a fundamental issue becomes the difference between development versus improvement. Formative evaluation, as originally conceived, was aimed at improving a model. Developmental evaluation is aimed at changing the model. In traditional terms, we would begin with a formative evaluation and move to a summative evaluation. The people in complex dynamic environments who are innovating and adapting to changes in their environment don't expect to get to a summative evaluation because they expect to continue to innovate and adapt. And therefore, rather than this model of moving from formative to summative, we get a much more complex dynamic picture where there are constant forks in the road and changes in the program and the program environment. And each one of those forks in the road becomes a developmental moment. So that the metaphors that we have about this, Bob Steak famously distinguished formative from summative evaluation by saying that the formative evaluation is when the cook tastes the soup to decide if it's ready to serve. Summative evaluation is when the guests at the dinner taste the food and make their judgments about the quality of the meal. Developmental evaluation is more like when the guests and the chef decide together that they want to create a meal by going to the market, seeing what vegetables and meats are available, seeing what's fresh in the market, thinking about what kind of creation they want to do, depending on who they're going to be preparing the meal for, who will be attending, what they've done in the past, what they want to do for this particular meal in relation to what's available in the market, and developing a special meal for a particular occasion based upon what's available in that environment. These slides, by the way, I want to thank Ricardo Wilson Grau for, who's been working with developmental evaluation, and it's helped develop some of the slides that I'm using today to explain the niche of developmental evaluation. And that is really what we're dealing with, is a particular purpose and niche. I define developmental evaluation as having the purpose to inform and support innovative and adaptive development in complex dynamic environments. Developmental evaluation brings to innovation and adaptation the processes of asking evaluative questions, applying evaluation logic, and gathering and reporting evaluative data to support project, program, product, and/or organizational development with timely feedback. This means that there's a focus on development versus improvement, accountability, or summative judgment. It takes place in complex dynamic environments. The feedback is rapid, as real time as possible, and the evaluator works collaboratively with social innovators to conceptualize, design, and test new approaches in a long-term ongoing process of adaptation, intentional change, and ongoing development. The developmental evaluator can be part of the intervention team or separate from it. The evaluator's primary functions are to elucidate the innovation and adaptive processes, track their implications, and facilitate ongoing real-time data-based decision-making in the developmental process. In this way, developmental evaluation does become part of the intervention. That is, the fact that the program is adjusting based upon data and feedback and interpretation and evaluative thinking, it becomes impossible to separate the intervention from the evaluation processes. This is what is sometimes called process use, which refers to and is indicated by individual changes in thinking behavior and program organizational changes and procedures in the culture that occur among those involved in the evaluation as a result of the learning that occurs during the evaluation process. Evidence of process use is represented by the following kind of statement after an evaluation. Quote, the impact on our program came not so much from the findings, but from going through the thinking process that the evaluation required. So it's a combination of findings and thinking that is built into the ongoing adaptation process. That's at the heart of a developmental process. This is getting called by other names, real-time evaluation, emergent evaluation, action evaluation, adaptive evaluation. What you call it depends upon your context and what's particularly meaningful to you. And of course, there is the potential of confusion between development evaluation and developmental evaluation. At the time that I began using the terminology developmental evaluation in the mid-1990s, development evaluation had not crystallized as a substantive field of evaluation focused on developing countries. And so as the field of development evaluation, which UNICEF and this series represents, has crystallized, developmental evaluation has also developed alongside that. And as this diagram shows, there is sometimes an overlap between developmental evaluation and development evaluation, but they are separate and distinct approaches to evaluation. And we have a large number of evaluation approaches. There's empowerment evaluation. There is theory-driven evaluation. There's accountability-based evaluation. There's monitoring. In the utilization-focused evaluation book I did, identified over 100 different approaches to evaluation. And so one of the challenges of a rich, diverse field like evaluation is to be able to find that approach that is best fitted to the situation that you face at a moment in time. When you go to buy a computer, you have to get a computer that meets your particular needs. When you go out to a dinner with friends, you pick which kind of meal people want for the occasion. We have lots of different kinds of evaluation, and developmental evaluation is simply one approach that is especially appropriate in situations of high innovation in complex dynamic environments. I find it helpful to draw on the work of Henry Mintzberg, who is a organizational development theorist at McGill University, who has studied the implementation of strategic plans by organizations. And he notes that over time, the organizations begin with an intended strategy, which is in their plan, but as the plan is implemented, the middle path here, shown by the arrow, is where those parts of the plan that actually get implemented as planned are what he calls deliberate strategy that supports the ultimate realized strategy, or what we would call an evaluation, the realized outcomes over some period of time. But what he also finds is that organizations that are paying attention to their environment, as they implement a strategic plan, find that some of what they had planned doesn't actually make sense when they go to do it, or the situation has changed enough that it's no longer appropriate to do what was planned, and so some things go unrealized. That's what's shown here in red as unrealized strategy. At the same time, new opportunities emerge over the course of 3 to 5 years, and so there are emergent strategies, or in the language of evaluation, emergent outcomes, so that where an intervention, a project, or a program, or an organization ends up over some 3 to 5 year period is not simply following a concrete set in motion plan and following that in recipe-like fashion, but rather organizations that are adaptive and developmental in orientation end up over a 3 to 5 year process. Where they end up is a combination of what they planned to do that was deliberately implemented, what they left behind, which was unrealized strategy, and what they picked up, which is emergent strategy. And where they end up, their realized strategy, or again in evaluation terms, the realized outcomes, is a combination of what they intended, what they left behind, what they picked up. And what developmental evaluation does is recognize that an adaptive organization will implement some things as planned, leave some things behind, pick some things up, and that part of our task is to document those decisions, inform those decisions with data, and help report on the basis for those decisions and their implications. A developmental evaluation report then follows this kind of map. What was planned, what got done that was intended, what got left behind, and why did it get left behind, what got picked up, how and why did it get picked up, with what implications, and how does that combination take us somewhere? Unfortunately, from this perspective, accountability-driven evaluations, and often summative evaluations, act as if organizations and programs and projects ought to end up exactly where they thought they would be 5 years earlier, and that that ought to be the basis of their evaluation. Whereas what complexity teaches us is that in dynamic environments, well-attuned organizations that are paying attention will in fact adapt to their environments and will end up different places. So developmental evaluation moves beyond these kind of static accountability models that simply hold programs accountable for implementing their plans as originally planned without having the opportunity to adapt to the learning that goes on as they implement those plans. This is part of a larger debate about what constitutes evidence-based practice. We say that evaluation grew up in the quote-unquote projects. Testing models under theory of change that pilot testing would lead to proven models that could be disseminated and taken to scale. This, of course, is the current search for best practices, or what are called evidence-based practices. And they assume that evaluation, summative evaluation in particular, will lead to a model that can be then replicated. This is a theory of change that the way you change the world is through the top-down dissemination of proven models. This is in contrast to a bottoms-up adaptive management approach where you are constantly learning and adapting. And I have positioned developmental evaluation as using theory-based, evidence-based principles as opposed to recipes to inform bottoms-up adaptive management, so that developmental evaluation helps negotiate top-down knowledge with bottom-up contextual understandings to help interventions adapt in real time to changes on the ground. This means that we are generating principles instead of models that are rigidly recipe-based, and disseminating and innovating around those principles. As we do so, we can distinguish developmental evaluation, which supports ongoing development, from fidelity-focused evaluation, which holds evaluations accountable for following a recipe exactly as it was summatively evaluated. So the conditions that challenge traditional model testing evaluation are these conditions of high innovation, ongoing development, high degrees of uncertainty, dynamic environments, emergent conditions, major systems change. Where you have those kinds of conditions, an adaptive management approach can be most appropriate, a management approach that's supported by developmental evaluation. Field Marshal Helmut Bernhard von Moltke famously said in World War II, "No battle plan ever survives contact with the enemy." This is the notion that it's good to do planning, but then we have to be able to adapt those plans in relation to real-world circumstances. Heavyweight boxing champion Mike Tyson said this in a more streetwise way: everyone has a plan until he gets hit. And the organizational management consultant Tom Peters called this ready, fire, aim. That is, you learn by engaging an environment, not just planning around an environment. So let me close my presentation by identifying five different purposes for developmental evaluation. The first of these, represented by the Blandon Community Leadership Program, is ongoing development of an intervention in a complex and dynamic environment where there is no expectation or intention of ever arriving at a standardized model. A second form of developmental evaluation is adapting effective principles to a new context. So principles have been identified elsewhere, principles like collaboration, principles like empowerment. And as we move into a new setting, those principles have to be adapted to a new context. And this applies to innovative initiatives that develop their own version of an intervention based on adaptation of the effective principles and knowledge. It is the opposite of fidelity-based replications. So adaptation rather than adoption and replication are the themes of the day. A third approach is developing a rapid response in turbulent disaster situations. In working with people who are involved in places like the Haiti earthquake relief, the tsunami humanitarian response, they are using forms of developmental evaluation to adapt in real time to rapidly changing conditions on the ground. Planning, execution, and evaluation have to occur simultaneously in those kinds of dynamic environments. A fourth is in developing models themselves. The formative-summative distinction comes into play once a model is already generated and it is being improved. But where do models come from? In highly innovative situations where people are generating or creating models, this is also a place for developmental evaluation. And so this is in what I've called the pre-formative space of potentially scalable innovations, where models are being generated. So that, for example, working in a community where the people in the community are going to collaborate to generate their own model, it's not ready to be improved because it hasn't yet been developed. Developmental evaluation can be pre-formative, and once a model is developed, it may move into the more traditional formative summative approach. And finally, developmental evaluation is appropriate for evaluating major systems change and cross-scale kinds of interventions or cross-sector interventions where there are many players, where the very nature of systems change is going to be dealing with complex dynamic environments where there won't be a single standardized intervention, but in fact rapid change, the interdependence of systems change requires developmental kinds of understandings and approaches. And in developing countries, we're seeing more and more calls for viewing things through the systems lens. One of the seminars done here, sponsored by UNICEF, was about systems concepts and evaluation, and those underpin developmental evaluation. Let me stop there with this quick overview and entertain your questions and responses.